Happy to be here. I was not very certain of the platform when I was designing the talk, because the talk was supposed to be given at a variety of different places, and I think this issue is such that it's relevant to a lot of people, not necessarily people who are AI enthusiasts or AI researchers or scientists, and that is what makes it so important. Another thing which makes it important is that it's a very it's a proto-science of sorts. It's not a very well-researched field yet. It can barely be called a discipline, the sociology of AI. And there are very few research centers in the world which have just initiated work on it. Like the AI Now Institute barely started. And hence, I am not going to be making any grand conclusions in this talk. I would rather that I incite some questions, incite some debate, and then we can probably have a discussion on them. I would not be offering a lot of solutions, because I think that's extremely arrogant to do so before a discipline has even been researched properly. And I would try to sort of clarify a lot of debates which have been caricaturized in the media, so to speak, because I think these are important issues and we all should be at least aware of what the discussion exists as of now and where we can go from that in multiple ways. There are parts of this talk you might not at all agree with me, and those are opinions, because this is not all fact. It can't be. The hard numbers don't exist yet. So there would be visions and opinions and my own personal ideology coming out, and I hope that is acceptable. Because yes, as scholars we have to even address those things. So let us begin. AI, society and politics of the future. I am at Anupam_Guha on Twitter, and Arek Collective is, like, I'm inviting people, whoever is interested in this non-linearity. So Arek is a Urdu word which means non-linear. So hoping that the future is not necessarily a linear continuation of the present. Okay. When artificial intelligence was conceived as a discipline, before it became even a discipline, decades back in the 50s and the 60s, when the mathematical foundations were being laid down of regression and things like that, we had a very grand vision of artificial, a very optimistic vision of artificial intelligence, so to speak. People thought that general AI or strong AI is a matter of years, if not decades. People thought that human consciousness would be figured out pretty soon, in a century if possible. And of course, that didn't happen at all. And there are many reasons why it did or didn't, but there was once upon a time when AI was conceived as something that would approach human intelligence, although intelligence was ill-defined at that point as a problem. And one of the pioneers of the optimistic sort of school of thought was Dr. Minsky, and who pretty much laid down the foundation of neural networks, who did a lot of interesting works. I would like to remind you of a certain problem Dr. Minsky wanted to do at that time. So I hope this is kind of visible. The font is a bit small. So what happens is that, like often happens in the summer, many students would come to professors and they would ask for projects, right? You do that here. These are summer interns, undergrads, master students, PhD students. Some student comes to Dr. Minsky and says, I want to do a project. And Dr. Minsky says that, sure, I have thought of a problem. It may take 3 months perhaps to solve. It may be a hard problem. It may take you 3 months. The problem is that, you know, human vision, they are basically patterns. You are observing things. They are essentially signals. It should be possible to make a neural network around them and solve them and classify them. So why don't you solve the problem of human vision in 3 months? It's a hard problem. Perhaps 3 months is too much of a time. Perhaps you will take less time. But 3 months, let's be pessimistic about it, right? Well, it has been 30 years, and I personally, as an AI researcher, work on the field of both computational linguistics and computer vision, and well, Dr. Minsky was optimistic. And that is what I mean when I say the disparity between what you think the linear projection of the present would be and what the experts think the linear projection of the, because nobody at that time could have considered an expert on AI of a higher stature than Dr. Minsky, yes? So that is where my skepticism towards the whole technocratic conversation around AI comes from, even now. That if we were that wrong then, and like people who were experts in the field, then obviously we are probably looking at things perhaps a bit more different than how things would turn out to be. This nice cartoon is something I've stuck in my lab in the States. It's a XKCD, a lot of you must be XKCD fans. So a person says that I want to solve two problems. Like if I have a camera, I take a photograph, I want to see where I am. And the programmer says, sure, give me a bit of time. I will use the geospatial tag or something and it'll solve it. And the person says, can I also say if my photograph has a bird in it? And the programmer says, sure, give me 5 years, a couple of $1 million, a team of undergrads to do my research, and perhaps it would be solved. So a thing in computer science, and I would say technology in general, is that the difference between what is very easy and what is impossible is not very intuitive, and hence becomes a problem for policymakers, who often get, I would say, driven by the narrative rather than what's actually happening. And that is where I think we need to be very cautious. And that is what this talk is trying to address over here. Because this talk is not just AI, but AI society and politics of the future. So a lot of this talk is going to be political. All right, just to remind people, I mean, some of you would know this, but I would like to address people who are not AI people in this room, that what is deep learning? So deep learning, this phrase, this buzzword has been flying around a lot recently. So to boil it down, it's basically again the same old neural network. These are just bigger, stronger neural networks. These are classification methods. So think of it as a box. A signal goes in, an output is matched. A couple of million signals are matched with their output. The box gets trained in a particular manner. Then you send it an alien signal and an output is classified according to the outputs which have been fed initially. So these are the training and the testing phases. Not all AI is classification, but a lot of AI is classification. And if you really think about it, there isn't a lot which comes under what you may call human creativity or human intelligence, which is not classification. A lot of what we do is making decisions. So when you use language, you are essentially making decision which phrase to use at what phrase. This became an entire discipline of computational linguistics or natural language processing, right? And using that, now it has come to the market where we have things like Siri or Alexa or voice, wherein you talk to a machine and seemingly the machine talks back to you. What it is doing is it's processing your patterns and using its trained knowledge, expressing a pattern. And as you can see, these are now very important parts of what the future economy would turn out to be. So communication like this. I'll give you a slightly more involved example from one of the papers I am referring this talk. This paper is a paper we presented at CVPR, which is a computer vision conference. And what we did was that we made the largest data set on earth of comic books. So we had a couple of tens of thousands of comics, and we wanted to create an AI which could rudimentarily understand comics. So what is a comic if not a sequence of images, each image being associated with some text? So theoretically, it should be possible if you boil down all the images into signals and if you boil down all the text into signals, it should be possible to train a deep network which will figure out what the last bit of text is. So in this comic, for example, there is this person who is flying on a cloud-like flying vehicle, right? And the cloud thing crashes down and the person falls on the ground. And then they say something which has been blacked out. And the answer is, of course, see, golly, I am still alive, right? The person is exclaiming surprised that they're still alive. Now, as a human being, you understand the sequence has some inherent meaning between it, and you sort of extrapolate the details which are not present in the images, which must have happened between the boxes, which happen in your imagination, right? And the way an AI does that is that the AI is not extra, because the AI only has the knowledge you have fed it, so only the training bit of data, right? So it has to make analogies from that. And yet, despite the fact that the model we made for this is nowhere near human performance, it still gives a better than random performance on some task as complex as this. And that really starts raising interesting questions among people, perhaps not AI scientists, but policymakers and philosophers, that, well, now it is comics, what next? Like, at what point do we have this, you know, distinction between, okay, this is human creativity? And frankly speaking, I'm not convinced that human creativity is this wonderful, beautiful, unique thing which cannot be replicated via just good old pattern matching. So, there is that. At this point, some of you, I mean, you know, this talk was designed for students. So, you are elders and essentially experts in the field. But I would like a show of hands. Are people aware of the Chinese room philosophical conundrum? Some of you? No? Let's then go into this. Imagine, if you will, that you are sitting in a room. The room is sealed from all sides. From outside, nobody knows you are sitting in the room. The room has two very small windows, and again, from the windows you can't like peep in and see that a person is sitting in the room. All you can do is pass A4 size sheets of paper through the slots, and you can receive A4 size sheets of paper through the other slot. One slot for sending papers in, one slot for sending papers out. Inside the room, there is a magical library or a magical book, and in that book, all that exists is every possible phrase of English in an alphabetical order, and alongside it, the corresponding translation in Chinese characters. It's an infinite book. You can get any English phrase from that book, all right? You are sitting in the room, you don't know a single word of Mandarin, how to understand it, read it, write it, anything. You are getting sheets of English from one of the slots, you're looking at the phrases written in it, you are quickly going through the dictionary, this infinite dictionary, you are finding the corresponding Chinese phrase and just looking at it, you are just copying it down dumbly, you don't really know what it means, you are just scrolling down the symbols and you are passing out the sheets from the other slot as fast as the sheets are coming in. Now, to an observer outside the room, it might seem that something intelligent is happening over here, you know, that Chinese is being translated from English, an intelligent process is being happening, perhaps the room is alive. But no, neither is the room alive nor the person sitting inside the room knows a single word of Chinese. It's just a pattern matching process going on, it's a dictionary. And if you really start thinking about it, all of AI boils down to this. The intelligence of AI, essentially, the semantics of an artificial intelligent construct lies inside the human, the meaning you attribute to those symbols. The machinery is not attributing any meaning, it doesn't have semantics, and often AI scientists abuse the word semantics, they keep using it in their model, they're like, this model can do semantics. No, actually it can't. This model is just having a sophisticated analysis of symbols. The semantics reside in the user. The user is attributing meaning to what essentially does not have meaning. To make a very reductive example of this, a long time back there used to be a chat bot called Eliza. You know, somebody wrote a bunch of script and the chatbot was fairly primitive. It wasn't really AI. You write a sentence, you're like, hey, Eliza, how are you doing? And Eliza would just take your sentence, twist a few words and it would be like, hey, Anupam, I'm doing well. It was a very simple script. And, you know, people formed emotional bonds with Eliza. Like, people would keep on talking to it for hours and hours. And the person who created Eliza grew frustrated with it, that people think this is AI, and wrote a huge paper, a scathing paper on the nature of humanity and how humans are essentially stupid idiots who would attribute personhood to anything. And I think that is a valid point to think about this reification of AI we are seeing right now. Now, just because it's pattern matching doesn't mean it's impressive. I don't know if you know the gentleman over there, but his name is Ken Jennings. There is a show on American television called Jeopardy. It's a quizzing show. And Ken Jennings happens to be the world's champion in quizzing. You know, he's the champion in Jeopardy. Spent all his life perfecting his craft, perhaps has been doing it from college era. You know, it's quizzing. I have done quizzing at college times myself. It's an interesting thing. You know, people who do quizzing, perhaps I'm seeing some heads nodding in the room. They like it. I also liked it once upon a time. It's very competitive, right? You sort of become, you treat it like a spectator sport. Like, you know, you have your fans and you have your local champions and you have your, you know, people you follow and you like it. And then a bunch of random PhD students from some university, unfortunately one of them was me, happened to be on a project which created a thing, which was a question answering project. So you feed it a question, it gives an answer. And we had it fight against Ken Jennings in a simulated quiz, and Ken Jennings was thrashed. So, you know, yes, perhaps pattern, just pattern matching, but unfortunately for some people, that is the their whole life's discipline. And then you de-romanticize it, sort of. So, what is the difference between what is happening these days and what happened in the 1980s? Remember, 1980s automation came from Japan the first time, and the hawa of all jobs would go had started around that time, and nothing happened, you know, nothing really happened. Contractual labor expanded, yes, and there was increased precarity, yes, but to a lot of technocrats who are anyways not the most sympathetic of people, they did not really start to realize what's happening, and I can't blame them, because the robots of the 80s were performing certain very specific tasks in very specific circumstances, generally on conveyor belts, you know, in assembly line production, and you needed humans to run them. So what used to happen is that you would take a token amount of your workers. You would, in a token fashion, retrain them, reskill them, as the phrase goes these days. The workers would be garlanded, sent back to the factory, and then their labor would be again taken out from them in form of value, right? No problem, although it was a problem, but it wasn't treated as one. The thing is that is not what is happening now. Now, you have these things. Now, this is I believe a propaganda photograph of my old lab, because that gentleman with the salt and pepper here is my old professor who I did my PhD under, Dr. Yannis Aloimonos. And the other gentleman who is trying to look cool for the photograph, he is my colleague, Alex. And the robot is a robot. The robot's name is Baxter. These are the new robots which are forming. And the robot can do a very decent amount of computer vision and pattern matching. So the robot doesn't do one task, you know. It does the task you train it for, because after all, what are your movements of your mandibles if not a series of decisions? So it can do whatever it can achieve by a certain set of movements, which can actually be extremely varied and versatile. So it's not a robot which will assemble cars or fold clothes or cook food. It will do any of them if that is what the classification task is. Now, at that point, because this talk is and will be given to undergrads as well. You know, undergrads are very bold. Some of them would raise a hand and they would shout out, "But sir, this thing looks clunky. And if I am to cook food, it will take me 10 minutes and this would never replace me. That thing cannot replace me to cook food, right?" I'm like, sure, it won't. That thing, it will take 3 hours to cook the same dish you will take 10 minutes to cook. The problem is that I am not paying it minimum wage, while for your 10 minutes, I have to pay you. I just need a power line with that thing, and then I can replicate the algorithm, which I'll probably get for free from some open source people, and just buy enough of them and place them around at various places. And cases of that are happening, right? So you have retail chains and things have started to change. Now, at this point, I wish to address something that A, I am not a technophobe. Okay, I spent my life and will spend my life doing artificial intelligence. So I am a huge technological optimist. And B, the debate around AI is being caricaturized. And that needs to be addressed in all platforms. In platforms which are, I would say, general, and in platforms which are specific and has experts. So the debate is sort of mischaracterized by the famous debate between these two gentlemen, Zuckerberg and Musk, right? So Zuckerberg here represents the sort of reductive Silicon Valley technocratic viewpoint, which is like nothing is, it is the same, it's just productivity rising. You guys are having a debate for the heck of it. There is no debate. It's just things are the same, it's fine, let's just chill. And then Elon Musk, who is not saying what is often portrayed in the media, but the media portrays it that he is being like, oh, the world is ending, we have an existential crisis. He doesn't help his case when he makes an institute called the Existential Risk Institute. But I want to, and I don't agree with Elon Musk's argument, but I want to sort of remove the mystere from around it and sort of boil it down to what exactly is the person saying. And I think it's an argument worth thinking about. When I say I don't agree with it, I don't agree with it in a time span he gives for it, but in the longer run, it will actually be a real thing to worry about. So if you want to understand Elon Musk's argument, what he's essentially saying is that no, he's not worried about Terminator situations or robots killing humans or some such fantastical thing, no. He's saying that you may end up creating pattern matching methods and algorithms which are slightly better than human. But in the same manner that you are slightly better than a murgi in certain pattern matching tasks, right? But that slight improvement in pattern matching between you and a murgi is all that matters. Like you would not look at a murgi as your equal. So what if that is the only level of difference we are talking about when it comes to intelligence? And and before we move on to what Silicon Valley responds to that, he gives a very interesting case, which again has been sort of hyped and it has been exaggerated and it has been, and you know, then MIT Tech Review comes sweeping in, writes a op-ed on that and creates a story on that. But let's hear the story. So here is a classic example which he gives, that perhaps you have an AI which has been given a lot of power over a lot of critical systems, production systems and all. And a part of that AI is tasked to defeat a certain human being in a game of chess, a very simple task, right? Unfortunately, the AI takes its instruction very literally. And in order to make absolutely certain that that particular human being does not defeat it in chess, that AI shuts down every critical system in the city that human being is currently resolving him, intending to kill that human. Because if the human dies, there is a 0% chance of that human defeating that AI in that chess game, right? The AI does not have a will of its own in this case. It does not have, it's not really intelligent. It's not even it's not wanting anything. It doesn't know what it is to want. But it is just carrying out the instruction to the best of its capabilities. And sometimes that is enough to shut down complex systems when an automated system carries out instructions to the best of its capabilities. And that is something which we need to worry about. That is what Elon Musk says. I may not completely agree with that argument, because again, it sort of reduces a lot of levels of complexities and a lot of chains. But again, this whole thing is so much exaggerated in the media that nobody even bothers to come down to that level to discuss it properly. And then, of course, that reduction is not entirely accidental, I would posit. You know, that reduction has an entire industry behind it, which we are all connected with. Here's the Silicon Valley. They are doing some wonderful work. You have the Uber cars, right? The thing about Uber is that you have this debate that what will happen to the 600,000 US drivers when driverless cars appear in the states, then what will happen to other countries as and when that starts happening. And I have not, I would like to be proved wrong on this, but I have not been shown numbers which sort of gives me the sort of hyper confidence Silicon Valley has for this, that, you know, things would balance out, it won't be a problem. I read a piece recently which was like, it won't be a problem, we would still need drivers, it would only need some assistance, and you know, a driver would be basically relaxing while the car is driving, only needs to do certain, you know, corrections. And a sort of pop culture counter to that, which was very interesting, I heard, is the argument of the Luddite horses. I don't know if you have seen that argument, but it's a very interesting argument. The argument is this. Suppose there are two horses in the 18th century, and one of the horses is very worried. You know, these horseless carriages, these cars, we are gone. Nobody will care for us. The other horse says, oh, calm down. See, our jobs will become easier when these cars arrive. We will have all the nice jobs, you know, the tourist jobs and the, you know, we'll be fine. All we'll do is less work. But that's not what happened to horses. You know, horse population decreased. So why do we, where do we have this psychological confidence that that automation, widespread automation, is going to suddenly lead to this outspurt of job growth in new jobs, and nobody ever defines what these new jobs would be, because apparently they will organically form and they have always organically formed, and that is not proof, that is ideology. And as we know, the warehouses in Amazon as we speak are being automated, right? And the numbers which are being cut and the numbers which are being added in the warehousing industry are pretty lopsided. Amazon makes these token job growth, you know, places that are, we are reskilling the people of this fala village somewhere, and I think those are Potemkin cases, like model village sort of thing, though I don't believe those are scalable things, and I haven't seen any number to convince me otherwise. So again, I have my doubts where that narrative is concerned. And then you have high skilled jobs like surgeons and lawyers and things like that. Here's the thing about law. As somebody who has never been a lawyer, the view us civilians have of lawyers is a very glamorous one. You know, we see court drama cases and we see lawyers arguing with each other and we are like, oh my goodness, what geniuses arguing with. And then I was reviewing some paper on AI which was automating a very simple part of law called charge determination. I did not know what charge determination is, but apparently you read some facts of a case and then the judge has to make that this is a charge. Okay. And this automated system apparently claimed that it can do it better than most lawyers can. Fine, good. And then I asked some lawyers that, hey, is this a very trivial thing? Should I just reject this paper out of it? And then, no. This is pretty impressive. Like people take, like this is a whole process and people do it and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, that's the thing, right? When we think about law in the popular imagination, we look at those two expert lawyers dueling it out in the court. We don't think about all those clerks, interns, the mandali which is following that lawyer around, the students and the junior lawyers and all those people who are doing very important work, whose work would be the first to be automated. They are the backbone of the industry, right? Similarly, when we think about surgeons, we only think about, in the popular imagination, we think about those genius surgeons who can diagnose all diseases. And what about the thousands of lab assistants and staff and students and whatever the jargon is, but you know what I'm talking about, the jobs which will be automated before the highly skilled professions start getting automated. I have some numbers though. So there is an argument which again is not original to me, it has been made a few times, but I want to like very clearly lay this down, that this thing about new jobs forming, which people keep saying, that's not really true. Most jobs in most economies on the planet, most countries on the planet right now, if you do a census, they are jobs which existed in some form more than a century back. So if you look at the US numbers, what are these? Cashiers, nurses, retail clerks, whatever. These jobs have existed for centuries. They are still the most employable job, the jobs which employ the most people. As you go down in the global south, this trend increases exponentially. So in Indian case, half of our workers are farmers, a job which has existed for thousands of years. So where does this narrative comes from of new jobs magically forming and replacing old jobs with technology? That is not true. Most jobs are boring jobs, the jobs which will get automated, and there is no historical trend that they would be suddenly replaced by new jobs. Now, the numbers say so. Unless, of course, a sudden historical shift will happen and you will have all these new jobs which nobody ever defines, that's not going to happen. Now, Deloitte and McKinsey did two studies, Deloitte for United Kingdom and McKinsey for United States, wherein they really went into the depth of the job market and try to find out what are the percentages of job which can be automated by already existing demonstrable technologies, not some science fiction stuff in the future. And the results were very surprising. The percentages are in the 30s and the 40s for many of these jobs. These analysis were not done on countrywide, they were done on local scales. As you can see, they went from city to city looking at the job markets, and these are developed capitalist economies. We are not even talking about Asian economies or South Asian economies, where things are much more fragile, where a number like a 30% unemployment is not even imaginable. You know, where a sudden fraction of shift in unemployment can cause a breakage in the market. Friends of mine who are in the construction sector would know this. So again, the precarity is a very real problem. The numbers prove that. And we can't get out of that by digging more. So, this is the wonderful quotes from newspapers about India. Right? See some more? That one, wherein somebody says that 400,000 were hired and then 140 and 160. And here's the interesting bit. Automation hasn't even reached Indian shores yet. The Indian job cuts in the IT sector had nothing to do with automation. They were to do with other technologies. The sector was bloated. Then you had technologies like cloud computing and stuff, and then they had to cut. And because automation was a convenient little scapegoat and it was being sort of exploited by the media and nobody was really critically analyzing it, they just hugged automation and they were like, yes, this is why this is happening. So it's not our fault, it's all external factors. But that wasn't true, of course. But if the industry is already bloated to that extent and we are seeing these kinds of cuts, and I am not even going to really worry about the IT sector because the IT sector represents a very elite part of the industry. But still, that is a sign of things to come. This is what I'm worried about. The hundreds of millions of agricultural laborers in our country. The thing is, we haven't really thought about agriculture. We still have huge precarity in agriculture. We have the agrarian crisis going. And we haven't even started thinking about what would happen when automation would become scalable in agriculture, when it would eventually become cheaper than human labor. And it will. So, no amount of bureaucracy would be able to solve this unless there are structural changes in how we treat agriculture in the country. Because we have this dual problem in agriculture. On one hand, you have a large amount of landless, skillless farmers. On the other hand, you don't have enough people to do farming. Like, you don't have skilled farmers who can actually do the farming for the land which already exists. And this duality of a problem needs to be investigated, and then needs to be investigated in the context of automation. These things are already in the market. These are very unimaginatively called hectares without hands. The idea is that this machine would just roll around a hectare piece of land. It will sow seeds, it will irrigate them, it will get the crop out. And we have to just wait for the time when these things would be mass produced to the point that they would be imported to India and then they would become a reality over here. Similarly, automated mining is already a fact of life in the United States and has created huge precarity for miners and has had both social and political consequences and will continue to have. Mining is one of the 8 largest employing positions in India. It employs a lot of people. And automated mining is going to become cheaper than human mining, cheaper, safer, etc. So, is there a national policy on this? No. And then, of course, 3D construction from China. So, China is working very hard on 3D construction, automated 3D construction. Some of their claims are a bit exaggerated. Some of it is not ready yet to be scalable, but it is very promising. And from what I hear, a lot of the barriers in that coming over here right now is still only a matter of cost. That still human labor is very cheap here, and you have sort of the bureaucracy which keeps outside things out. But those are not permanent factors. They will evolve with time and adjust with time.
L&T is already trying to build automated toilets.
Yes. Right, in the north, right? So, I heard that after the earthquakes in Uttarakhand, L&T tried something like that there as well. So, and you need automation. Like, you need automation to scale processes and improve processes which need to be improved. So, breast cancer detection, for example, each year breast cancer kills around 40,000 women in the United States itself, way more in the global south. And this team of people, they figure out a way to do AI detection of breast cancer, which was provably better than humans, had a higher positive detection and a negative false positive. when it comes to breast cancer, and that was reviewed by doctors, and it created a huge sensation. Not everything is about quality as well. If you look at the African continent, a lot of countries in Africa don't have the ratio of doctors to people which is needed. So in many African countries, you will have one doctor for 1,000 civilians, and you can't really solve that medical issue without using automation. You need automation to help doctors to scale their processes to the point that much lesser medical staff is needed. So where I'm coming to is that it is, the problem isn't automation or production, the problem is structural. And the same thing becomes good or bad depending on how the structure is being formed. And here we need to critique solutionism. May this slide be taken as a representative slide. I am not going to make any comments on Aadhaar over here. But people have commented that Aadhaar is a classic case of solutionism. And to explain the phenomena of technological solutionism, I always use the pressure cooker example. So the pressure cooker example is another thought experiment. Suppose we are all living in 18th century Britain with the accompanying social and political problems that existed in 18th century Britain, which means that the women in the room don't have a lot of rights in 18th century Britain. Can't vote, you're treated pretty much as property, in fact. And this leads to a social protest, this leads to a movement. Imagine, you know, people are protesting on the streets, people are coming out in the streets, and they are like, we want rights for women. And then some analog of a technological solutionist arrives in that culture, and they say that, okay, what's the problem? Explain the problem to me. And because you don't even have the vocabulary to express the problem, because the feminist literature isn't a thing yet, you present the problem in a very reductive state. You say that women in our culture are working too much compared to men. They are doing a lot of unpaid labor. That's how you express the problem, although the problem is deeper. And the solution is, they say, oh, fine, we can solve the problem easily. Here, I have made this invention. It's called the pressure cooker. This pressure cooker is going to suddenly reduce all the labor of all the women. So women equality achieved. Of course, nothing really happened. You still don't have the right to vote. You still don't solve any of the structural issues. Just have pressure cookers. That is what technological solutionism is. It's trying to solve a problem by applying technology on it without understanding the social or the political deviances which underlie that problem. And a lot of the debate when it comes to modern technological solutions, I think that is where the problem lies. A modern example of the pressure cooker. So if you use Google Translate to translate, this became viral, and I think it's a wonderful example actually. So if you use Google Translate to translate Turkish into English, it's like, he is a soldier, she is a teacher, he is a doctor, she is a nurse. Now, the algorithm isn't sexist, it's human society which is sexist. The algorithm is a reflection of human society because it takes data from everywhere, right? But it's interesting because this is not an academic problem now. We are using this. We are using Google and a lot of other similar products in our culture, and we will be using more as automation, as it permeates. And this is only an issue about fairness, right? But then there are other problems aside from fairness, like power. And I'm not even addressing power right now. I'm just talking about fairness, and fairness itself, well, there is how it goes. Let's have another example of which has both in power and fairness involved, problems with both power and fairness. So when the American elections happened, people were shocked for certain reasons which are unmentionable here. But Google again flew in like Superman, and they were like, we are going to solve it. And Facebook also, yeah, we are going to solve. We will destroy hate speech. Hate speech and bigotry will disappear from the internet thanks to technology. So they made a thing. Now, Google calls itself something new these days, ABCD, whatever, alphabet. But some subsidiary of that made a thing which was like, we will find out what percentage of toxicity a certain phrase has. And yes, it can find toxic words. The problem is, toxicity does not reside in syntax, it resides in semantics. And no matter how good your AI is, you can't resolve semantics. So, what you end up with is that You are a part of problem is 16% toxic. Some races are inferior to others is 18% toxic. But your comment is highly toxic is 68% toxic. And this is not an academic thing. This software exists. You can use it. It's in the market. It's out there. The code is out there. And Google, of course, later said, oh, we'll just improve it, tweak it a little here, tweak it a little there, and perhaps these problems will go away. But that doesn't address the fundamental problem that this is not a solution. The solution to racism is not to police language using machine learning, right? Racism is a very fundamental problem. You can't solve racism or sexism by applying technology over it and many other problems. So what is the answer? Am I a Luddite? No. But I would like to say that the Luddites were mischaracterized and the Luddites were sort of caricaturized and the Luddites were treated in the same manner as skeptics of solutionist capitalism are being treated right now, which was that, oh, they hate machines. Why would a human being in the right mind hate machines? The Luddites were facing real precarity. The market was excluding people from jobs. They had nothing to eat. In desperation, they broke the machines to convey a political point. They didn't hate machines. That's stupid to even, like, that's infantilizing your enemy, basically. So, again, that is the comparison we can make right now. So, what is the solution? Well, some people, by which again I mean Silicon Valley, due apologies to any representatives of the Silicon Valley here. I am a part of the culture, but I can critique it. Some of them look at their like, oh, robots will take all the jobs. Fine, we'll have so much wealth. Fine, why not tax the wealth and spread it around? Universal basic income, they call it. It's being promoted a lot. And it's a very complex issue. I don't want to make any definitive statements on universal basic income, but the idea is that you will have all this extra wealth and you will just redistribute it basically. And everybody will get some money without any conditions, with no strings attached. Some tests have been done. Finland tried to use universal and basic income on 2000 people. It gave them some money and just observed what they will do. And yes, people were very judicious about the extra money they got. They did not waste it on, you know, the standard tropes of booze and drugs and whatever. No. The people were very judicious. They use it for educating their kids or to repair their houses or to do good things. Basically, they improved their lives and became better citizens. And of course, in the Indian case, some numbers are being thought of, you know, perhaps 1,500 per extremely poor family or something like that. I am not a huge fan of UBI, to be honest. Because again, to me, UBI is another level of solutionism on an already solutionistic way of thinking. And I can't really express that in numbers right now, but if you want to look at it ideologically, this is what I think UBI is, that image. It's basically kharat. That's what the word in Hindi is. And it's not solving the issue of AI, or rather a very huge accelerating concentration of wealth being concentrated more and more into a very small locus of very few agents. UBI does not change the way you look at property, and AI remains corporate property essentially. And because it remains corporate property, it produces so much, it will give an extreme amount of leverage to people who control it, and then it would be naive to think that those people will not have any influence on national policy or political policy. They will. So at that point, some people will get to decide what is the judicious amount of money which will be distributed to those who are not unemployed but unemployable for no fault of their own. Because the people are not unemployed because they are lazy or any such thing. They are unemployed because the system makes them unemployed. And that will be there in the future as well when AI happens. So unemployability. So UBI essentially doesn't change the problem. It doesn't address the structural imbalance in my opinion. Again, might be completely wrong. Might be that the numbers do make sense eventually. It's a question that needs to be investigated. That is redistribution enough, or do we need to think of something more radical? Because in my mind space, UBI is not really radical enough. And that's where I wish to address the question of ideology and property.
Yeah. So you're saying that UBI, like corporate, I agree that the technology is in the hand of very small group of individuals. But isn't UBI, the essence of UBI is that it is the wealth is going to be redistributed by the government, which is of the people. And the government is going to tax the corporate.
Theoretically, the current governments are also of the people, and yet,
they have the influence.
And that influence is not trivial. Like in policy, we assume that influence is a strong variable, right? So, assuming that somehow the separation of church and state in this case, church being the church of AI, I am not that confident. Perhaps I am being extremely pessimistic about how the state will operate at that time. Again, I might be completely wrong, and it may be. It's a conversation to be had, and perhaps imagination needs to be made on how to prevent that. Perhaps I want to address this thing properly. So there is the question of ideology and property. My thing is that why do we imagine artificial intelligence in the same property equations we have had till now? First of all, where is the value coming from? Value comes from data, right? You have this millions of data points you are using to train your artificial intelligence models, which yields to so much productivity, wealth, etc., etc. Where is the data coming from? The data is coming from the people. You are the ones with the Facebook accounts, you are the one with the Aadhaar numbers, right? So the data comes from free. It's harvested from the people, so to speak, and then it gets concentrated into these definitions of property which needs to be challenged, I would say. And my way of looking at AI is that not only is the data being socially produced, the knowledge, the algorithms are also socially produced. Most of the research in AI is being done in universities across the world. Universities are publicly funded and publicly assisted institutions. The human talent which goes into these universities comes from society, students and researchers. So you have the knowledge which is producing the wealth is also socially generated. The data which is the building blocks of that wealth is socially generated. But somehow the wealth becomes the property of the ownership of that algorithm, which is generally corporate. We have to address the elephant in the house, inequality here. The simple thing is that if you have more than 6 lakh rupees as your entire family wealth, you are in the top 8% of the wealth percentile of this country, which means most of the people in this room are aristocrats of some sort. And the problem is that the aristocracy of most countries of the world imagines itself as the middle class and gets to decide policy in rooms like these. And I have a problem with that, a very radical problem with that. If you earn more than 66,000 a month, you belong to the top 1% income earners of this country. And AI is going to keep concentrating it. So if you are in the top 1%, 66,000, a lot of you must be earning in this room. You don't get to decide how property on AI will be decided. Not just you, it won't be allowed to happen. It's not equitable or ethical. Right? Have we ever had situations where structural problems of these sorts were handled? We did. There was the Great Depression, and many lessons were learned there on how to treat both property and labor to emerge out of that. I think that is a place we can learn from. Again, I'm not giving any strong solutions. I'm just saying that what might be the questions to ask or what might be the solutions to ponder about. Our own Verghese Kurien brought up a completely new model from scratch of a cooperative of cooperatives of sort, which he called the Operation Flood. And there are lessons which we can learn from that as well. It was quite a success for the time of precarity we were in post-independence India, where both the formal and the informal economy were in shambles. The average health and average nutrition were at the bottom of the pits. And Amul still exists and does well. And I'm not saying that that model does not have its own problems and its own concentrations of wealth and power and privilege. It's just that we need to start being inventive when it think about AI. There's a company in Spain I rather like. It's called Mondragon Incorporated. The interesting thing about this company is that all 60,000 workers of this company are also the owners of this company. It's a complete cooperative. All the workers sit in councils. They elect their bosses. Now, the thing with these kind of structures is that established CEOs say, this won't work. This can't be profitable. This can't work in a market. And Mondragon works perfectly. Mondragon has a very modest annual turnover of $20 billion. For 60,000 workers, that's pretty modest. But it is a profitable company and it is completely democratically managed. Here you see Mondragon workers voting for their things. An interesting thing about Mondragon is that in any ordinary company, even in India, the ratio between the salary of a CEO and a salary of a chaplasi is always around 2000 to 200 is to 1, right? In Mondragon, the ratio of any level of hierarchy to the lowest level of hierarchy is never more than 5 to 1.
What does this corporate
do? They are what you call a multi, so they do energy and they do retail and they do material and... So, I am not going to uncritically praise them here. They are not free for, they have not created utopia like inside their company, or they may have inside their company, but certainly not outside. I was reading reports that Mondragon was involved in some shady deals in South American rainforests. So, yes, all fair inside, but outside they will be as brutal and as market oriented as any of the other players. They will take contractual workers and pay them less than their own worker comrades or whatever. But again, something to think about. And what about an Indian example which is not Amul? So, when the British left India, there was a chain of restaurants they left behind without any managing staff, owners, anybody. And the waiters in those restaurants thought that perhaps we might just be able to run it ourselves. We don't need owners. Many of you may have eaten in these restaurants. They are called India coffee houses. They exist in a lot of cities. They are all, I mean, they may not be as glamorous as the Mondragon slide with workers voting like this, but they are also basically that. They are also a cooperative of cooperatives. And that model I find really interesting for AI when I speak about how to control AI, because to me, redistribution is not enough. Start thinking about property if you are policy. Finally, I would like to say that I don't know what the future will look like, neither do any of you, or neither, certainly not those people who write very convincing op-eds in newspapers. I have been one of them, that this is what the future will look like. When helicopters were invented, people thought, some artists thought that you would go around in helicopters riding them like horses, throwing bombs with your hand in the ground. The technology existed, you just did not have a conception of how it will be socially used in the future. We don't have helicopter cavalry right now, which means that the future did not turn out the way they thought. The future was not a linear extension of what the present conditions were, and cavalry was obsolete. These images are very interesting. I call them visions of the future past, right? These posters they used to make in the 1910, 1920 about what the future would look like, what 2000 would look like, when they would have these spaceships and children running calculus from gigantic monitors. And there were kernels of truth in them because their imagination was pretty good. And I think we need to really start being imaginative about the problems which AI would have. And I hope I have instigated you to think on some of those terms today. I would like to end with saying that ultimately I am a technological optimist. I would like to think that humans and artificial intelligence will have a very fruitful and productive relationships. And the fruits of that productivity would be equitably distributed. I am Anupam Guha, and please follow these handles. If you are on Twitter, we would try to sort of generate some conversation. I mean, my personal handle is there, of course, and RX Collective is the one we are forming to have some people talk about AI and policy. Thank you.